fourth night of affecting a culture for Christ. One night, we just had slides and stuff like that where we looked at Ephesus. We said last week that in Acts 19, let's go to Acts 19, the story of Demetrius and Artemis and the makers of silver who confront and try to take the life of Paul and the Christians, 25,000 strong, in this very theater. This is the Roman theater of the time of Paul. This is where all of this took place. You can visit it today. He entered the synagogue, continued speaking out boldly for 3 months, reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. One of the ways to confront our culture for Christ is to be bold and to be persistent. He was persistent in that he went on for 3 months, we said. To be bold means to be free without any fear or restrictions. This past week, I had the opportunity to be a little bold in one of my classes. Humanism came up. We were discussing humanism as one of the psychological schools of therapy. And one of them said, well, this humanism seems like it's kind of atheistic. Well, guess what? I didn't bring it up. They did, right? And so I took off on humanism, talking about it was a replacement for God, and that man becomes God. And I began to talk about how even churches were becoming humanist, in that they were accepting sin in the church because they wanted to be loving. They wanted to be loving. We want to love everyone, and we want to love people, and God says we should love people. And I said, it's, you know, we have become even atheistic in our churches. And a couple of them said, excuse me, what the heck do you mean by that? That our churches have become atheistic? We're part of a church youth group and we're not atheistic. And I said, well, I bet you're humanistic. And they said, well, what do you mean? I said, are you willing to tell a gay friend that what they're doing is sin? Are you willing to tell them that it's sin? Well, the whole class just gasped, you know. And I think that I have a gay person in the class. And they all kind of sucked a little wind, and one of them said, well, I mean, we're supposed to love everybody. We're supposed to love everybody. I said, can't you love somebody enough? I said, now, listen, I'm not telling you people that you have to believe in heaven and hell. I'm not telling you that you have to believe in the Bible. This is a secular course at a secular university. But I'm talking to the Christians who pretend that they believe the Bible. And they said, what do you mean pretend? I said, if you're not willing to say my book and my God says this is a sin, and I love you enough that I believe that sin could send you to hell, and I don't want you to go to hell, I love you so much that I'm willing to stand up and say that's a sin, and I wish that you would repent and change your mind. I said, is there a person who comes to your Christian church, your Bible-believing church, that does not believe that we all have to repent? We have something that we have to repent of? And they all shook their head and said, yes, we believe that we have to repent. I said, then why doesn't the gay person, why are they the only person that doesn't have to repent in your congregation? Why are they the only person in your youth group that doesn't have to repent and change their ways? The rest of us have to, but we're giving them a pass. Why are we giving them a pass? Because the world is our God. You see, the world is our God, and we don't do that. And one girl made the mistake, bless her heart. She said, well, the Bible says, judge not lest ye be judged. I said, I just dare you to read all 12 verses of that. You've plucked the one verse out that actually is misrepresented. Because it says, don't judge lest you be judged by the same manner in which you've been judged. So if you judge in a godly way, then you'll be judged by God. And according to your God, homosexuality is a sin. Now, I'm not telling you that it is. I'm not telling you you have to believe that, students. But I'm saying, if you are a Bible-believing Christian, you should believe that. and that you have to judge in a godly way, because those people will be judged by God in a godly way, and it will be on your hands that you didn't love them enough to tell them. I got 3 thank you emails from students saying, I've wondered about that. And I didn't know how I was supposed to feel about it. And one of them said, I went to my youth pastor, and he said, this is one of those things that we cannot know this side of heaven, but when we get to heaven, we'll know the answer. How much are we paying this guy? That's what I want to know. How much is he getting paid to be in that position? Whatever it is, even if it's volunteer, he's being paid too much. So anyway, I did get to preach the gospel in class. And I tried to be bold, and I tried to be loving, but when I said, you just aren't judgmental enough, when she said, judge not, I said, we're just not judgmental enough. And I pointed out that there's a difference between the sin and the sinner. There's a difference that we love people, but we hate their sin. So it started a good conversation, and it started an email back and forth from some of the students. We'll see where it goes. We'll see. And I've not heard anything from the person that I believe is gay, who's rather flamboyant, but doesn't do it in class. I mean, doesn't bring it up. They're not militant about it, but their actions are, look at me, that's who I am, kind of thing. Okay. So anyway, we looked at some verses then about being bold and persistent. We also said that those 3 months... We're sticking with it, hanging with it, that we don't back down, that we continue to press on and press on and press on. We don't ever wash our hands of our loved ones, our family, our world, and say, well, that's just the way it is. And believe me, the Christian church has done that with sin in these days. We've said, the law has been passed, we can't do anything about Roe v. Wade, let's just pray for the rapture. We can't do anything with the homosexuality that's already been taken care of, let's just pray for the rapture. We can't do anything about this and that and the other, and let's just pray for the rapture. Folks, we've given up. We are in the middle of a battle, and we've all laid down our weapons and said, where's the choppers? Where's the choppers to come and get us? Take us out of this battlefield. Take us back to the BX. Take us back to the canteen. We don't have that option. Until God stops the battle, we have the command to continue to fight. And we have the command to continue to press forward. Because remember, the very gates of hell cannot stand against us. We are to be attacking them, not them attacking us, okay? All right, so to be bold and persistent, this is kind of where we left off last week. Reasoning. The word here is that he reasoned with them. In verse 8, reasoning and persuading them. Reasoning means to seek their level of understanding. He got down where they were so that they could understand it. Okay? He didn't speak, now please don't take this wrong, but he didn't speak in some old English terms that people couldn't understand. And he didn't do some Elizabethan Shakespearean sonnet about God and his mercy. I remember a great preacher who was a total heathen before he got saved. And he said the first time he went to church, he and his wife were sitting there, and he kept looking at her saying, I need a cigarette. Will it bother him if I light up? I need a cigarette. Can I have a cigarette in here? Do you think it's okay? I don't see any no smoking signs. I mean, that's how heathen this guy was, okay? He really was. He needed a cigarette. And the preacher got up and he said, well, he looks pretty cool. He bounced up there and he's like, hi, welcome to service today, and we're so glad you're here. And he said, that's a really good MC. That preacher's a good MC, master of ceremonies. He's great. He's really got the crowd pumped up. He's got us clapping and everything. He's a great guy. And then he said, shall we pray? Oh, our Lord God. And he said, what's wrong with his voice? Why did he change? What happened? He was all hoopy-doo, and then, oh, Lord God. He said, I felt like I'd walked into an Elizabethan play all of a sudden. Our God, thine and thou'st. And that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about getting where they understand it. I am fully aware of the fact that there is a need for skateboard missionaries. Do you know what I mean? Kids who will spread the gospel to people who ride skateboards. I think there are people who need to be ministering to street people, that there are people who need to be ministering to ethnic groups and different languages. I believe that there are people who have a call and a ministry to surfers, to cowboys. Don't you? Believe that with all my heart, that there are ministries who do that. And what are they doing? They're getting down to the level of understanding. They're reasoning with those people. They're getting where they live and saying, do you understand that this is what God has done for you, in a way that they can grasp it, in a way that they can understand it. For years, people said, if they want to get saved, let them come to the church, hear the sermon, walk the aisle, and get baptized, just like we do. Come on in here, and if you're not wearing a tie, we might accept you, but we're going to give you one. Get a tie at the door, you know, so that you're acceptable. In other words, you got to come our way, you got to do it our way, you got to do it the way we do it, this is the way it is. And how many of you know that that's what it talks about when it says that Jesus went among the publicans and the sinners? A lot of people point to that and say, Jesus went to the bars and drank. He went to the bars where they were drinking, but it wasn't to get drunk, it was to hopefully to get them to repent and leave. It's one thing when we go to join the crowd. It's another thing when you go there to pull them out of the crowd. That's the difference. So, getting where they are, seeking the level of understanding. Literally, this word is used in the Greek in poetry for taking a line and dangling the bait in front of a fish. Dangling the bait in front of a fish. It's getting their attention. It's luring them in. It's telling them the truth in a way that is attractive, in a way that draws them rather than turns them off. Do we know how to speak to our grandchildren in a way that does not turn them off, that becomes attractive to them? Sure. Just using the word dude isn't it, okay? Right. Hey, dude is not the way to do it. Do we know how to do that? Do we care enough about them to learn how to do it? But there's another word that's used here. Look at 9:8 again. Look at it with me. My Bible keeps turning off. Reasoning and persuading. Now, there's a reason that there are two words here. It's not the same thing. Reasoning and persuading. Persuading means landing the fish. Persuading means closing the deal. So we dangle the bait, that's reasoning, making it attractive. Persuading means, come on, you're one of us. You're one of us. This is closing the deal or landing the fish. Many times we do one but not the other. Sometimes we try and just land the fish. I believe with all my heart, and I may be wrong, but I'll admit I may be wrong on this, but I believe that the biggest thing is that I have been commanded primarily to cast the seed. We are here to spread the word. Okay? If we get a harvest, that's a godly thing. But if I continue to cast the seed and continue to cast the seed, and 2 years later Bob comes along and suddenly it's his harvest, is that okay? You see, it is. There are going to be those who reap, and those are going to be those who sow. And every one of us has been commanded to go and tell. Yes. Period. It doesn't say go and tell and quit when you don't get any results. No. And that's where a lot of us live. We don't see enough results, so we say, well, this isn't working. I'm not very successful. Evidently, I don't have the gift of evangelism. You don't need the gift of evangelism. Every believer has been told to go and to make disciples, to tell. We have that calling. So we have got to learn to reason. We've got to learn to persuade. I don't believe that every church has to have a skateboard ministry. I don't believe that every church has to have a homeless ministry. I don't believe that every church has to have a divorce ministry. I believe there are churches in the body of Christ that would be called to that ministry, And when all of the ministries get together, we have a body. We have a body. We probably, in our town today, have a reputation as a church as being a retirement church. You ever heard that before? A retirement church. Yeah. That we're a retirement church. We're a church where retired people go because y'all are tired and you don't want to do the work of ministry anymore. And I invite some of those folks to just come try us. Just come try us and see how retired we are. How real we take the gospel. Amen?
Yes, sir.
There's a reality in what we do. But we each have a place. The eye cannot say to the hand cannot say to the foot, I have no need of thee. We need all of our ministry. So we've got a level of understanding. A writer and a pastor by the name of Timothy Keller. I agree with some of Timothy's theology, not all of his theology. I agree with some of his books, not all of his books. You know, let's face it, he is not nearly as perfect as I am. Thank you for laughing. But anyway, Timothy says that there are four basic witnesses, and I think this bears repeating. I can't take credit for it. I'm quoting another guy, okay? I don't do that much, but I think these are worth repeating. Quickly, just, we have the traditionalist, he said. The traditionalist in witness is the one who says it's in my terms with no effort to understand you or your context. In other words, you come to church, you get saved, and everything will be all right. Wear the tie, wear the coat. You come as, not as you are, but as we are. And I'm just going to say, this is it. Like it or lump it. That's the traditionalist. I live on my tradition the way I witness. And I don't really have any empathy for where you are in life or what you're doing. The second type of witness is called the manipulator. And we've all seen this kind of person in the pulpit or on TV or radio, where they will say just about anything in the world to get a decision. They will manipulate the heck out of it. I believe that they'll fib, they'll stretch the truth, they'll tell a lie, they'll strike fear, they'll talk about miracles that never happened, they'll talk about visions they've never had, they'll talk about rich people or poor people who got rich that never happened. But what are they doing? They're trying to help the kingdom of God. They're just manipulators. Are just manipulators. The third type is the accommodator. It's almost the opposite. The accommodator will just about say anything that's necessary to get you to make a decision, as long as it's what you want to hear. We'll surrender the truth and tell them what they want to hear if they'll just pray the prayer, if they'll just come to church, if they'll just become a Christian. I think we have a lot of that on TV too. You know, that Christians are supposed to be rich and wealthy and prosperous, and Christians never have any problems again in their life.
Really?
That's the accommodator.
God wants you to be rich.
God wants you. Yeah. Yeah. And then you have the fourth type, which I believe is the one that we should strive to be. And he calls it the preacher. The preacher. And he says, a good preacher will not sacrifice the truth, but be willing to communicate in the language of the listener. We will not change the message, but we might change the way that we give it. Isn't that a better way to witness? Don't change the message. I call it an unchangeable message to a changing world. And boy, are we in a changing world. And the closer we get to the end time, the faster the world's going to change. You know, on the outer rim of a vortex, things move pretty slow. But the closer you get to the center, the more whipping fashion there is, and the faster things go. And when we're going down the drain, as our world is, what is happening to that centrifugal force near the center?
Speeding up.
Speeds up. The circle that's this big becomes this big. And we are whipping and whipping and whipping and being thrown. Where I grew up in Salt Lake, there was a little town north of Salt Lake that had an amusement park called Lagoon. And it was built around a lagoon that had a big paddle boat in it. And you could ride the paddle boat, and it was an Oscar's paddle boat that they had resurrected and rebuilt and used in this amusement park. But there was roller coasters and all the typical things that are amusement park. But they had one of the old-fashioned kind of fun houses. The old kind that had rocker panels that you walked on. And one of the things that they had was called the disc. And the disc was it was about the size of these pews. It was huge. You got a bunch of people on it. And all it did was start out very slow, and then it spun faster and faster and faster. And the idea was to try and get as close to the center as you could, because if you got off of dead center this much, you were going to be thrown off of that sucker. That was one of my favorite rides there. It was one of my favorite rides because we'd get out there, there'd be guys kicking girls, you know, like that. You know, we're 12 years old, you know, and saying, goodbye. And they'd go flying off. And guys would be crawling all over each other like a pile of dirt, you know, and playing King of the Castle, trying to get to that center point before it got too fast to survive. Well, that's exactly what our world feels like. That if you're not standing in the center of God's will, you're going to feel like you're being thrown off of this place. There was a musical in the 60s, Stop the World, I Want to Get Off. You remember that? And the spinning of the world, I want to get off. An unchangeable message. Look at Acts 19:9. But when some were becoming hardened and disobedient. Now, what are we being? We're being persistent and bold. We're being bold and persistent and bold. But even being persistent and bold, in verse 9 it says, but some were becoming hardened and disobedient, speaking evil of the way before the people. Paul withdrew from them and took away the disciples, reasoning daily in the school of Tyrannus. Folks, there comes a time when we have to give people to God. If you have witnessed to your loved ones for 20 years, there comes a time when you are beginning to bruise the fruit by talking to it. Yes. You know what I mean? You begin to bruise the fruit. In Kings, we hear the story of the school of the prophets. One of my favorite stories in all the Old Testament. Favorite story of the prophets who went out and they would take their axes and they would cut wood for the fireplace so that they could cook and eat. The job of the sons of the prophets, of the school of prophets, those who were students, was to go get firewood. And they would walk out and they would take their axes and they would cut down wood. And we know that there's not a lot of woods in Israel, but we know that there used to be a lot more than there are now, that the country's been denuded about 4 times in history by conquering people. But there used to be a lot more forest than there are now. But they would go out and they would take their axe and they would chop down the wood. And it tells the story of the one who went out with his axe and he swung back with his axe and the axe head fell right off, just flew right off. He went, and all he came back with was a stick. Whack! I mean, I don't know. It's a Bible story, but for me, it's Looney Tunes, okay? It's a cartoon because you can just see him shaking because he hit that. And it says that he continued to chop at the wood, but had no head, had no axe head. He said, Lord, I've got no axe head. And he went over to the water and he said, Lord, I need the axe head. And the axe head did swim, King says. That metal head rose to the surface. And that praying prophet was able to reach in and regain his axe head. And he put it back on the handle. And he secured it into place. And he went back. To me, that's a picture of the Holy Spirit. We can witness all we want to without the Holy Spirit. And all we're going to do is bruise the bark of the forest that we're trying to win. But if we ask for the Holy Spirit to come, ain't nothing can keep that tree from being chopped down. Even losing the axe in the water. And the axe head did swim, it says. Going in the power. There comes a time when all we're doing is bruising the wood. And we need to give them to God. Here Paul stepped away with his disciples and went someplace else. Look at Matthew 10:14. Matthew 10:14. Whoever does not receive you, nor... what's it say? Come on. Heed your words, okay? They don't heed your words. As you go out of that house or that city, shake the dust off your feet. There comes a time when you just give them to God. You don't walk out of the city and go, I hope you all God die and go to hell. Hope you're damned to forever, you know? Just shake the dust off your feet. That's a symbol. It's a symbol of, I'm not personally responsible for you. It's like Pilate washing his hands. That's what it is. It's washing his hands and saying, I'm not responsible. Do what you're going to do. There comes a time when we shake the dust off and say, 20 years. You know the word. Now, God, sick them. Get them. Do what I can't do and what I haven't been able to do. Look at Acts 13. But the Jews incited the devout women of prominence and the leading men of the city and instigated a persecution against Paul and Barnabas and drove them out of their district. They didn't write them off, but they did shake the dust of their feet in protest against them and went to Iconium. You see, it's a symbol. It's a symbol. They did it in protest. It's something that the people of that day understood. It's, you want us to leave? You're on your own, buddy. You're on your own. That was something that everyone in the crowd understood what was going on. We're not talking about a metaphorical thing that you do in your mind that you say, well, just, okay, I'm giving you over to God. Today we don't have a symbol like that, except we might look at our loved ones and say, I have told you for 15 years that Jesus loves you and you need to repent. And you and I both know that you need to. I know it and you know it. You may pretend, you may fight, and you may play, but we both know that without this decision, you're going to die and go to hell. Now, you know that I love you, but I'm no longer going to bring it up. Now it's between you and God. And I have actually looked at loved ones, not in my family, but in my ministry, and said, and I'm telling God to get you. Just tell him. I'm telling God to get you. My telling you has maybe protected you in the past. But now, get him, God. Get him. And that's exactly what was being done here with Paul and Barnabas. He's telling them, get him, God. What was the school of Tyrannus? It was just a lecture hall. It was a lecture hall that could be rented or used. And the idea was that if you wanted to talk or lecture, you could use that hall. And so he went to a place in town. Where had he been? The synagogue. Been totally synagogue oriented. Now he's saying, let's go to the lecture hall and let's hang out there because we're not going to the synagogue anymore. Now, a lot of people will make the mistake of looking at the verse and say, oh, so he left the Christians and the church. No. He took the church to the school with him. We're talking about the synagogue. We're talking about lost Jews. We're talking about the unconverted that he left behind. He didn't turn his back on the church and walk away. A lot of people say, well, the church hurt me and I ain't never going back. Paul left the church. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. He left the synagogues. Right? He left the synagogues. And they were full of lost people. And so it was them that he was walking away from. Lecture hall versus synagogue is what we're talking about. Let's go to another place then. Today, we have the church. We have the synagogue, which is a religious place that doesn't have salvation in it. How many of you know there are churches that meet every Sunday that don't have salvation in them?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, every Sunday. They meet and they got pretty parking lots and pretty churches and pretty people. But we're not going to see them where we're going. And then we have the world. We are called to all three. We are called to disciple the church. We are called to save the synagogue and the world. And that's our calling. That's our ministry. Acts 19:10. Be bold and persistent. He taught at the school of Tyrannus for 2 years. This took place for 2 years so that all who lived in Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. Amen?
Amen.
When we're talking about being this bold and persistent for 2 years of spreading the gospel, he had covered all of Asia Minor. Which, in our thinking today, if we take Asia Minor today and look at it, we're talking about the country of Turkey. It was a heathen time back then and a heathen place back then, and it's always been. Turkey is the crossroads between the East and the West, has been a battleground forever, and I believe is going to be one of the pivotal countries in the end times and the final battle. And if ever there was a player who could play into the hands of the Antichrist, it is the Prime Minister Erdogan today. He is an anti-Semite, atheist. The money that comes from Iran and Iraq, about 50% of it gets funneled through Turkey. That goes to Hamas, Al-Qaeda, ISIS. It goes through Turkish banks. They are the money and the source. The ships that Israel, the last three ships that Israel stopped from reaching Gaza that were full of contraband had all left ports in Turkey. Let's leave it there. We'll talk about 11 to 20 in our next period.